Thank them for being here this morning to discuss how we can improve our current system of higher education financing. Most of us, if not all of us, will agree that the current framework is far from ideal. From a student's perspective, rising student debt means greater difficulty in obtaining financial stability early in their careers, impacting important life decisions, such as buying a house or starting a family. This is particularly true in light of the slow economic recovery, where lower-paying entry-level positions create additional pressures for young Americans. From a taxpayer's perspective, the free flow of federal student loan dollars to higher education institutions without proper incentives to control costs will continue to lead to higher tuition prices charged to students. While loans to cover tuition are relatively easy for students to obtain, many are not adequately informed as to the implications of this debt for their ability to achieve post-graduation financial success. Greater system-wide accountability and transparency are needed, and our witnesses will be sharing their thoughts with us today on how to best achieve these goals. I'm pleased to have Purdue University President Mitch Daniels, former governor of our state, before us today to talk about his several initiatives to control costs, to improve financial literacy, and create value for students attending Purdue. President Daniels will be outlining, among other incentives, the Bet on a Boiler Income Share Agreement pilot program and how Congress can assist similar higher education financing reforms. I'm also looking forward to hearing Dr. Kelly's thoughts on how our current student loan system distorts the higher education market and the role competitive principles can play in making higher education more affordable for everyone. And finally, we're also pleased to welcome Mr. Chopra, who will outline the need for proper safeguards as Congress considers alternatives to the current higher education financing arrangement. With that, I look forward to discussing these issues in more depth with our witnesses today, and now want to recognize Ranking Member Maloney for her opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Coates, and welcome to all of the witnesses. A rapidly growing student loan debt is a significant challenge facing our country. Student loan debt grew steadily through the recession, more than doubling from the start of the recession in 2007 to today, and is now close to $1.3 trillion. Student loan debt is now almost twice the size as credit card debt, which is a staggering statistic. More than 40 million people have on average more than $27,000 in debt. The recent explosion in student debt risks the economic security of Americans and threatens our economic growth. As debt levels increase, young people are forced to delay buying a car, purchasing a home, starting a business, and saving for retirement. And some end up paying back their loans well into their 30s, 40s, and 50s. Now, how in the world did we get to this burden on our young people? Part of the story is that many American families have struggled in recent decades and have had trouble saving money for their children's college education, and many were hit hard by the recent recession, the most severe economic crisis since the Great Depression. When parents have less savings, students are forced to borrow more, substantially more. In fact, borrowing has gone up sharply in recent years, with the average debt at a four-year public institution climbing from $21,000 in 2006 and 7 to over $25,000 in tuition in 2012 and 2013. Another critical part of the story is that tuition has risen dramatically, especially at public colleges and universities, which educate the vast majority of our students. States have also been hit hard by the recession, and in response, many have slashed funding for higher education. Median state funding per student, for example, fell by almost one-fourth from 2003 to 2012. Cuts in state funding for higher education force public universities to charge more. As a result, this forces students and their parents, they have to pay more. and this means that students have to borrow more money to go to college. With a declining state investment, tuition increases have far outpaced inflation since the 1980s. After adjusting for inflation, tuition and fees at a public four-year university more than tripled in the past 30 years. The Bush-era recession increased the overall amount owed by students in another way. As job opportunities shrank, more and more young people opted to enroll in school, and they had to take out loans to pay for it. The recent recession also accelerated the loss of many higher-paying jobs that did not require a college degree, further increasing the demand for college or other post-secondary education. For-profit institutions in particular saw their enrollments surge, quadrupling between 2000 and 2011. A new report finds that 75% of the increase in student loan defaults between 2004 and 2011 results from the increase in borrowers at for-profit institutions. Student debt is a big problem. And how do our Republican colleagues suggest that we respond to this problem? By restricting the availability of federal student loans and by expanding the private student loan market. As recent history has shown us, private student loans pose significant risk to borrowers. These loans often lack consumer protections. They typically carry higher interest rates, some greater than 18%. Many borrowers have been forced into default when lenders wouldn't renegotiate viable repayment plans. Income-based repayment and extended loan terms plans are available with federal loans, typically are not available with private student loans. And there are many, many examples of private lenders really preying on student borrowers. Defaults can affect employment background checks and cause lasting damage to a person's credit and their future ability in their professions. There is probably broad agreement in this room about the need to continue to clean up the abuses in the student loan industry. It's been the Wild West with providers marketing their loans to students desperate for financing through every conceivable channel: Pandora, YouTube, campus, off-campus, and in many different ways. As we consider new private options for financing a college education, we must make absolutely sure we have strong safeguards in place to prevent private lenders from using any type of predatory practices to take advantage of students. Today, we will discuss a new private lending mechanism, income share agreements, that could offer some students an alternative way to finance their college education. I would like to hear from our witnesses what they have to say about this issue. I would also like to know specifically how they would protect students from any predatory practices that have been a part of the existing private student loan market. Rather than look to the private sector to magically solve the student debt problem, we should strengthen public support for higher education. It's important to remember that an educated workforce is a good, a public good, and thus without government involvement, we would underinvest in education. There are four steps that we can take right now. First, we should make tuition free for students at community college. Students would then be able to build their skills and perhaps obtain an associate's degree without taking on huge debt. Second, states need to partner with the federal government to reinvest in higher education and to begin to reverse the years of budget cuts at the state level. A third, at the federal level, we should increase investment in Pell Grants to give low-income students a real shot at a college education. Despite recent increases, Pell Grants now cover just one-third of the cost of going to a public university. Finally, we need to reform the system so that universities and colleges have some skin in the game, some consequences. When a student is unable to pay back a loan, and colleges should be rewarded when a student does succeed. Before we take the advice of of my Republican colleagues and scale back federal student loans and increase private lending to students, let's take a minute to remember how much students benefit from federal loans. Much lower rates, better consumer protections, income-based repayment, extended loan terms. College has been a gateway to opportunity for generations in our country, but for too many Americans, as the price of college rockets up, the dream of an affordable college education slips away. Our goal should be college education that is more accessible and more affordable. The federal government, state governments, universities, colleges, community college, the private sector, and families all have a role to play. I look forward to our discussion today. I thank the witnesses for their commitment to this issue. I look forward to their testimony. I might say that it's good to see a former leader here in Congress. Welcome back, Mr. Daniels.
Thank you, Kim.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Let me introduce our witnesses. President Mitchell Daniels is a longtime friend coming from my home state of Indiana. He became the 12th president of Purdue University in January 2013 at the conclusion of his second term as governor of the state of Indiana. President Daniels also comes from a successful career in business, holding numerous top management positions. He is a member of the board of numerous nonprofit organizations, including the Urban Institute and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences Commission on Post-Secondary Education. Additionally, he serves as co-chair of the Committee for a Responsible Federal Budget. Mitch Daniels earned a bachelor's degree from the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton University, as well as a law degree from Georgetown University. Warm welcome to you, President Daniels. Yeah. Dr. Andrew Kelly is a resident scholar in education policy studies and the director of the Center for Higher Education Reform at the American Enterprise Institute, where he works on higher education policy, innovation in education, financial aid reform, and the politics of education policy. Dr. Kelly received his doctorate and master's degree in political science from the University of California at Berkeley and a bachelor's degree in history from Dartmouth College, and we thank you, Dr. Kelly, for being here today. We're going to have a cell phone turn off. What? I need to get a screen like they do in the movies, you know. So if everybody would silence their phones, that'd be helpful. Finally, Rohit Chopra, who is a senior fellow at the Center for American Progress. Previously, Mr. Chopra worked to establish the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau and served as part of the senior leadership team. Mr. Chopra earned his bachelor's degree from Harvard College and a master's degree in business administration from the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania. With that, let me turn to President Daniels as the first witness, followed by Dr. Kelly and Mr. Chopra. And I thank the witnesses for being here this morning. Apologize for being late. We had a vote at 10 o'clock in the Senate. I was the first to vote, the first out of the chamber, so we're doing the best we can.
And I've just been called to a vote in committee. Be back.
President Daniels.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The two thoughtful opening statements we just heard.
Would you press that?
Thank you.
There you go.
The two thoughtful opening statements that we just heard make it plain there's no need to rehash the dimension of the problem we're facing, except to affirm that it's still getting worse. Last year, by close to another $100 billion, 7 or 8%, on top of the astonishing number that Ranking Member Maloney reminded us of. Our research partners, Purdue's research partners at Gallup, just yesterday released the second installment of the biggest study ever of college graduates and documented the blight that on young lives that the debt is causing, postponing housing, postponing purchase of cars and durable goods, postponing starting businesses, postponing having the children this nation's going to need to meet its obligations decades from now. That's our principal concern, economic and personal cost. It's also, of course, a fiscal catastrophe, or should I say another one. It's overrun its projections in 6 of every 7 years, by my reckoning, the debt programs that we have today. And you saw the biggest write-off ever, $22 billion. We all know it's just the first of many to come. These same young people who were indebted are indebted to the tune of almost $60,000 for public debt that's been run up, not for investment in their future, but for current consumption. And we shouldn't forget that this issue we're discussing here today contributes to very directly to the buildup of that. But we're here to concentrate on the constructive. I have three things among many that we could talk about. Transparency and information, very important. Secretary Duncan was on the Purdue campus 2 weeks ago. We commended him and thanked him for the new scorecard. It could be improved. It, for instance, would help to see data on earnings program by program, because averages can be deceiving. But that's a good start. At Purdue, where debt is down $50 billion in the last 3 years, or about 23%, a major factor has been a four-year freeze on tuition. We are halfway through it. But we have found that a little information and a little counseling goes a very long way in helping young people and their families make better decisions at the front end. So things the federal government can do to encourage that, very important. Accountability, which the education system lacks end-to-end and everywhere, is a factor here, too. I completely agree with Congresswoman Maloney's suggestion that colleges share in the risk that their graduates will not be able to meet their obligations based on the education they received. And you can sign Purdue up for one, more than willing, and find that more than appropriate. And many of us believe that some new approaches are in order. And just to center on the one that we were invited to talk about, so-called income share agreements. Very important, by the way, they were loosely mentioned a minute ago as lending. They're not lending. That's their principal distinctive feature, in my opinion. Think of them as equity as opposed to debt. We see them not as a panacea, but as an important addition to the portfolio, maybe a replacement for PLUS and most private loans, which I quite agree are the biggest locus of the problem we have. They shift the risk from the student to the investor, not the lender, but the investor. They provide limits and they provide some certainty to the obligation that a graduate will have. They would know that never more than an agreed upon, negotiated, freely chosen percentage of their future income in any given year would go to pay back the investor. You want debt-free education? Here it is. So we want to thank Congressman Young, Congressman Polis, for this bipartisan House initiative, and I'm very encouraged to hear that it has some prospects. It will be necessary, in our opinion, to provide clarifications on subjects like state usury laws and tax treatment, and as was mentioned by Ms. Maloney, protections for reasonable protections and boundaries for those who might participate. I will say there's one thing about the bill that I recommend a closer look at. I would believe that like other equity investments, income share agreements should be dischargeable in bankruptcy. As you know, student loans are not. It's another way in which they are can fairly be described as indentured servitude. They're the most onerous form of debt we have. I would suggest changing the bill to indicate that ISAs are dischargeable in bankruptcy. But we thank the sponsors, and we appreciate the bipartisan nature of the look that's been taken.
President Daniels, you have not lost your touch. You spoke for exactly 5 minutes. you ended at 5 minutes on the second. I appreciate the content of what you said and the brevity with which you said it, Dr. Kelly. I'm not trying to put too much pressure on you, Dr. Kelly, but
setting a very high standard, as always. Good morning, Chairman Coates, Ranking Member Maloney, and distinguished members of the committee, and thank you for the opportunity to testify. My name is Andrew Kelly, and I'm the Director of the Center on Higher Education Reform at the American Enterprise Institute. We are a nonprofit, nonpartisan public policy research organization, and my comments today are my own and do not necessarily reflect the views of AEI. I'm here because the federal approach to financing higher education is on an unsustainable path and too often fails to help those who need it most. While federal per pupil aid increased 46% over the past decade, net prices and out-of-pocket costs at most institutions have never been higher. Simply pouring more money into the system will not solve these problems and may make them worse. That's because the federal student aid system suffers from four design flaws. First, it essentially empowers colleges to capture as much federal aid as they can. Aid eligibility is based in part on the cost of attendance, which colleges control. In addition, colleges use detailed financial information about their applicants, furnished by the federal government, to price discriminate, often substituting federal grant aid for their own institutional resources. Second, a lack of clear comparable information on cost and quality makes it difficult for consumers to identify the most valuable options. Systematic data on student outcomes like learning, job placement, and earnings are rare, hindering consumers' ability to make prudent borrowing decisions. This reduces market pressure on colleges to compete on price and quality. Third, there is almost no underwriting in federal student lending. Any high school graduate can borrow to attend any accredited college at almost any price. Federal loans and grants provide no signal to students about the value of different offerings and allow them to enroll in poorly performing schools. Fourth, existing policies do not exercise sufficient quality assurance. Federal eligibility criteria are far too generous, meaning few schools ever lose access to grants and loans, no matter how poor their outcomes. Continued access to aid props up colleges that would never pass a market test. In short, the problem is not only that we make so much money available in student aid, but that we make so much money available with very few strings attached. One potential consequence is the Bennett hypothesis, the notion that increases in federal aid cause increases in tuition. Existing research on this question is mixed, but most studies find that at least some types of colleges raise prices in response to federal aid. A recent study found that for every dollar in subsidized student loans, colleges raise tuition prices by about 65 cents. It is difficult to identify whether aid causes tuition increases, but it certainly seems to relax the incentive to keep tuition low. The Bennett hypothesis has helped explain why federal investments have not kept tuition low. But the focus on price increases ignores a more pressing problem, the failure of federal aid to promote higher education quality. Aid policy provides colleges with plenty of incentives to enroll students, but less reason to worry about whether they are successful. New college scorecard data suggests that at a majority of colleges, at least half of the alumni earn no more than a high school graduate 6 years after enrolling. Default rates are highest among borrowers with low balances, and even inexpensive institutions like community colleges have low repayment rates. These patterns indicate that higher education's problems go beyond tuition inflation. For far too many students, federal aid is providing access in name only. With these challenges in mind, there are several reforms that would encourage colleges to compete on price and value. First, capping PLUS loans to parents and graduate students, which allow unlimited borrowing up to the cost of attendance, seems like a straightforward way to curb tuition inflation. Second, federal policy should empower consumers with better information about costs and student outcomes. The College Scorecard's new earnings data is a start, but the federal government should expand on this effort to collect and make public program-level outcome data. Third, policymakers should create two simple accountability mechanisms based on loan repayment rates: a performance floor that would exclude the worst performing institutions from federal aid programs, and a risk-sharing policy that would give institutions above that floor greater skin in the game. If all colleges were held responsible for a percentage of their students' unpaid loans, they would have incentive to contain their tuition, maximize rates of student success, and reconsider their admission standards. Fourth, reform should create space for private financing that can inject more market discipline into higher education. In theory, private investors could underwrite on the basis of program quality and future earnings, driving students toward valuable opportunities. Existing private student loans do not appear to be forward-looking in this way. More than 90% of new private loans feature a cosigner. An alternative is an income share agreement, under which students obtain funding for school in exchange for a percentage of their after-school income over a set period of time. Because an investor's return is directly tied to a student's success, ISA providers have incentive to help students navigate toward valuable opportunities. There are a number of for-profit and nonprofit entities trying to offer this option to students, but a lack of legal and regulatory clarity has limited the growth of this market. Policymakers like Senator Marco Rubio and Representatives Todd Young and Jared Polis have introduced bills that would provide such clarity and put common sense consumer protections in place. I appreciate the opportunity to provide testimony, and I look forward to the discussion.
Dr. Kelly, you almost, Matt, you're 3 seconds so over. I think we've set a standard here now. Mr. Chopra, you really are under a lot of pressure, but we look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, for having me today. I'm someone who's always been a big believer in the power of competition, whether it's Olympic runners training for a big race or a burger joint looking to be the best in town. Competition can push us and help us be our best. But like many others, I'm also someone who believes that competitions and markets don't reward the best when competitors cheat rather than compete. Today, I want to talk about our student loan market and the need for common sense rules of the road to promote fair competition that protect consumers and honest businesses. Now, we don't have to go very far back in history for an example of what happens when businesses cut corners. This month marks the 7th anniversary of the collapse of Lehman Brothers and the acceleration of the financial crisis. Sketchy lenders and mortgage brokers push borrowers into exotic new products, sometimes using bait-and-switch tactics that led to surprises on closing day. We didn't get the benefits of competition. What we got was catastrophe. Families across the country saw their home values plummet, their retirement savings crater, and their jobs vanish. With state budgets squeezed, support for higher education slashed, and household wealth slipping away, more families couldn't pony up to pay for college, making more and more seek out student loans. Since the collapse of Lehman, outstanding student debt has doubled, with debt per borrower far outpacing the growth in tuition. While most of our student loan market consists of federal student loans, private competition has played a big role in the student loan industry, but with mixed results. For example, there are upwards of $500 billion in student loans originated using private capital still outstanding. Now, in theory, private lenders could have participated in the federal loan program and competed on price and service. But it turns out it didn't work as planned. An investigation by the New York AG didn't find lenders competing. He found them cheating. Lenders gave kickbacks to schools and even transferred company stock to key financial aid personnel. By the end of 2007, the 8 largest lenders in the market, including some of the biggest names on Wall Street, signed codes of conduct, and many paid millions to settle charges for wrongdoing. Our private student loan market, the one operating outside of the federal program, isn't doing much better. Like the subprime mortgages that skyrocketed in the boom years, Wall Street securitization of private student loans surged, giving lenders the ability to sidestep schools and aggressively target families without clearly explaining that private student loans didn't include some of the key protections of federal loans, like income-driven repayment plans, which would prove to be a lifeline for students who graduated in a tough economy. Recently, regulators have started to crack down on some of the worst abuses. The Justice Department fined Sallie Mae and Navient millions for ripping off military families. The FDIC tacked on even more for their illegal student loan servicing practices and violations of anti-discrimination laws. And just this summer, the CFPB fined Discover for illegal debt collection tactics and for inflating billing statements. None of us like the outcome of the game when athletes are doping or when the ref is in cahoots with a bookie to favor one competitor over another. And in the marketplace, we are all better off with sensible, well-tailored rules and a fair referee. In the student loan market, honest actors and consumers will all benefit if we make disclosures clear, ensure that servicing and credit reporting are accurate and free of conflicts of interest, and repayment plans in times of distress are not gimmicky Band-Aid solutions. That's how competition can help every student reach the finish line instead of being part of a race to the bottom. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions and the discussion.
Dr. Chopra, thank you. I will start with just some questions. I'll try to adhere by my own rules as a quarterback or point guard looking at the play clock. As I get down to zero, I'll have my staff poke me in the back and say, time's up. President Daniels, Dr. Kelly listed several things here that, and you did also, relative to responsibilities, accountability, transparency, a number of things as we address this. What I'd like to hear you talk about is what is the responsibility of the university relative to these tuition costs, other related costs that are rising 2, 3, 4 times the rate of inflation. What is the role of the university and the accountability that they must engage in? You suggested a couple of things, and I think you've done more, from what I understand, at Purdue to be accountable from the management side of the educational institution in getting control of its costs, because ultimately that drives up the cost to students and to parents that are and students that are having to repay these loans.
Well, up until recently, I guess you'd say that the responsibility was purely an ethical or professional one, and it wasn't very often honored. Colleges raised prices year on year on year because they could, and they were certainly wind-assisted by the gusher of federal money. It's perfectly well documented now that that this has been a driver of higher costs, made it easy, far too easy for those increases to happen. I think that belatedly, market pressure has begun to assert itself, and none too soon. As I mentioned, at our university, we froze tuition the last 2 years. We've pledged to keep it there the next 2 years. Don't know beyond that. Can't go forever, but we take that very seriously, and we are aggressively promoting our university as on a value basis, quality of the education divided by its cost. And you know, our partners at Gallup yesterday revealed that among those graduating from college in the last few years, there's a very big difference in how they value the education they got, whether they think it was worth it or not, compared to those who graduated 10 and 20 and 30 and 40 years ago. So there are signals that universities be well advised, not to mention better stewards of their responsibility, if they were more careful about their costs. And I think those that that aren't are going to be taking an increasing risk in what could be a shakeout in higher ed coming.
In reference to that, this Wall Street Journal article yesterday about the Gallup Purdue index. I might just quote from that, the steep decline in the perception of whether a degree was worth the cost startled Brandon Busteed, Gallup's executive director for education and workforce development. He said, when you look at recent graduates with student loans, it really gets ugly really fast. Yet if alumni don't feel they're getting their money's worth, we risk this tidal wave of demand for higher education crashing down. That's quite a statement. You were Purdue participated in that effort, and with all our well-intended goals of educating our young people for the challenges of employment challenges of the future, here, if this persists, that certainly puts us in an ever more difficult position in terms of that. And whether you, President Daniels, or Dr. Kelly, or Mr. Chopra want to just quickly comment on that, I've got 1 minute left. I'd like to get your response to that.
Sure, I'll say three things quickly. You know, there are three important trends to keep in mind here. Number one, we all know what's happened to tuition prices. Number two, the labor market outcomes of recent college grads have not looked good. And it's not just a function of the recession. If you look at wages for the youngest workers with a bachelor's degree, they've been on the decline since about 2000. But the third trend is also really important, which is that the fortunes of high school graduates have been even worse. They've done even worse in the labor market. So people are paying more for a degree that's earning them less money, but having a degree is more important than ever before because the counterfactual is worse. And so we need to keep that in mind when we're thinking about debt and whether debt's a net negative. The counterfactual of not having the debt is not having the degree, which is much worse in many cases.
I think there's a lot of talk about the college wage premium, that is the difference you earn over your life between getting a degree and not. And it's very interesting. This is all fully explained not by the increase in wages for college graduates, but the decline in wages for everybody else. So what we have is a combination on an inflation-adjusted basis of flat or declining wages for college graduates and more and more and more debt. And the combination of those two isn't really good for the credit capacity of our country in terms of formation of small business loans, mortgages, and others. So it's both sides we have to look at, the debt and the wages.
Thank you. My time has expired. Congressman Maloney is a designated Congressman Beyer as a ranking member, which entitles you and those of us up here. We'll be followed by Vice Chair Brady and Vice Chair Klobuchar, and then we'll get the titles out of the way. rest of you can engage. So, Congressman Blair, you're on.
Thank you, Senator, very much. And thank you very much for coming. Governor Daniels, President Daniels, in my prior life, I'm an automobile dealer. So we spent an enormous amount of time arranging loans, which vary greatly depending on the credit history and the credit scores of the customer who's before us. On the ISAs, why wouldn't they only go to the most creditworthy or to the people that the private investors who are going to have an equity stake in this person see that have the greatest possible return? What will this mean for, especially if we dial back on plus, what will this mean for the lower income or the lower expectation student?
Well, we'll have to see, Congressman. My belief and supposition is that if the market does take off and begin to mature, you'll see a spectrum. Those who have the very best prospects, yes, will maybe the first approached with these contracts. They'll also be able to negotiate the very best terms. I still think it could be, at least up to some point, much more advantageous than other options like PLUS loans for those who might have to commit a higher percentage of their income or for a slightly longer time, but would still get the benefits of having shifted the risk in a way that debt does not, and having secured some certainty and some limits to that percentage of their future wages that would be taken up paying for college. It's, you know, I've described it elsewhere as working your way through college after college, and those who wound up or chose a less remunerative career quite naturally would have a different set of terms, but it doesn't mean it wouldn't be better for them.
Governor, why the need to have exemption from state usury laws?
Because it's not debt. This is an equity investment, is by the way, that's why I don't think it, why I do think it should be dischargeable in bankruptcy. But if we're really going to shift the burden and shift the risk away from the graduate partner here, then we should treat it in that fashion all the way around. Now, the bill as drafted does have upper limits. I think that's just fine. It does have extensive consumer protection. I think that's just fine. But I think it would probably strangle the plan in the cradle if we let it be subject to usury laws, which 50 different flavors, which really don't apply.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Governor. Mr. Chopra, in the move to away from PLUS loans, and they're relying on the private sector, I'm concerned about the many things I read, that the private sector loans have higher interest rates, that they don't have some of the other options that the federal borrowers enjoy, income-based repayments, flexibility for forbearance, financial hardship deferment. Federal loans are fixed interest rate, the private loans are often floating. Is there any reason to think that moving away from the PLUS system of the private wouldn't make the problem worse?
Well, I think unlike a lot of other consumer products, there's really not many consumer protections when it comes to these consumer loans that are marketed as private student loans. In my testimony, I mention some of those issues, everything from credit reporting to the treatment of service members to anti-discrimination laws, and I think we'll need to think about updating that. One of the things we learned in the lead up to the financial crisis is that regulators failed to exercise decent judgment on when the market was spiraling out of control for subprime mortgages. Disclosures weren't working well. There were problems from beginning to end. And I think it's good for us to take another look at the student loan market, particularly if we're thinking of new products entering. I appreciate Governor Daniels' distinction that it's equity versus debt. But for a student, the difference between the products, it's a different financing transaction. And I don't want all of them to need a PhD in finance before they even enter college.
Okay, great, thank you. And very quickly, I read that a third of all our college debt is actually postgraduate, mostly law school and medical school, and another third are the for-profit colleges, which leaves you only a third that are the traditional undergraduate college educations, and that most of that is related to the increasing number of kids going rather than the debt per person. Is that accurate, Dr. Kelly? And are we overstating the crisis?
In terms of the big growth in student debt over the past decade that people tend to cite, the aggregate number, that is a function of growing enrollments in large part. It is also a function of growing enrollments in graduate school. Some estimates of graduate school debt peg it at more like 40%. And I do think that raises a really important point for policymakers as they think about the student debt problem writ large, disaggregating the grad school debt from undergrad debt and the struggles therein, I think, is really important.
Very good. Thank you, Doctor. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Vice Chair Brady.
Chairman, thank you for calling this hearing. Thank you for the witnesses. This is a bipartisan issue, and I also appreciate Representative Hanna's nearly daily interest in student debt and college financing. I had a young man in my office the other day talking about healthcare issues. He's in graduate work, medical profession. He has $600,000 of debt. His fiance, also in healthcare, $400,000 of debt. The reason I can't remember the topic he wanted to talk about is I kept looking at him, thinking, "You've got $1 million of student debt," and thankfully that's not the case with everyone. But it illustrates where we've become. This committee is about the economy. We had a tough recession. Good news is we've had many months of job creation. The problem is it's very low. It's like a car that's stuck in first gear, 15 miles an hour. The problem is this is the most disappointing recovery in half a century. We're missing about 6 million jobs that should be in the economy right now, many of those available for college graduates. We're missing an economic hole in America's economy about the size of Canada's economy. And for Family of Four, we're missing about $1,100 a month from our family paycheck that ought to be back right now, which is a lot of savings for college. And the challenge is the adults in the workforce is almost at what it was 7 years ago. So college graduates are having trouble finding a job. They have high student loan. They're postponing purchases, but also hurts the economy. So today, how do we tackle this? We can go with the stale old ideas you always hear up here, which is more federal regulation of state colleges and universities, or encouraging students to borrow more, so then go deeper in debt, or free everything, which almost always comes with a bill later on. We're looking for fresh, new 21st century solutions. That's what this hearing's about. I wanted to ask Governor Daniels, one of the keys on financing seems to be much greater knowledge about what degree you're pursuing and what income that generates later so you can make good decisions. That's starting, it seems to me, the door's cracked open at the state level, but nowhere near what it needs to be. From our level, what can we do to encourage at the state level that type of knowledge for students and parents? So just as we have a skills gap today, you know, jobs versus the skills we need, so we don't have that dream gap of what that degree might generate versus the loans they might pick up. What advice would you have for us?
First of all, I wouldn't underestimate the extent to which today's young people and their families are focused on that. Overwhelmingly, they tell us that's almost to an excessive extent, that's why they're going to college. That's what they're looking for. What will get me a good job at the other end? There are other very important aspects of higher education that I hope we don't lose sight of. You know, nobody should think of it as vocational school, but there's a real fixation on that now. At Purdue University, we teach, this is readily available information, I show people, we teach 11 of the 12 most highly paid degrees, or careers by most often associated degree. We are, unlike a lot of other schools, experiencing a surge of applications, up 15% last year after a record increase the previous year. And when we ask why, it is because I think students are newly concentrating on the likely benefits of a degree, and they're also looking at, you know, at price on the bottom of the fraction. So the other thing I would say, though, is and Andrew made reference, one benefit of adding to the inventory of possible financing tools, an equity-like tool, yeah, like we were discussing, is it would serve as a signaling mechanism. Back to the congressman's previous question, you bet those who would invest will bid more aggressively for the degrees and the likely careers that they believe that they see as a most as strongest in the market.
And it seems to almost dictate, demand almost a cost-benefit analysis for a family, you know, or a student looking at where they want to head, what they can pay and afford to pay. And so all that seems to, this is a fascinating solution. And your point, I think, isn't this is the only solution. It ought to be another tool for families and students to finance their education.
That's right. I mean, I favor a broad reform. It's not the subject of this hearing, but broad reform of the student financing scene we have today. Andrew's written and Rohit both have written persuasively on those subjects.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We welcome back the ranking member in time to do your questioning.
Thank you. There seems to be a general agreement that tuition increases are driving the explosion in student debt. And I'd like to understand why it's jumping up so much. And I know, Governor Daniels, that you froze tuition when you went to Purdue, I believe, in 2013. And that's a wonderful thing to have done. But I'm interested in your perspective on the tuition increases prior to your coming over the past decade. And tuition and fees for an in-state undergraduate at Purdue increased from just over $6,000 in 2004 and 5 to almost $10,000 in 2013 and 14. So that's an increase of almost $4,000 in 9 years, a 64% increase, roughly 2.5 times the annual rate of inflation during that period. And could you give us some perspective? I know that was when you were not there, but why did Purdue raise tuition rates so dramatically during this period? What were the causes for this 64% increase?
They wanted to spend more money. They did it because they could. I'm not being critical. They were our university, it was no different in either in their case, 36 years history of continuous increases from almost any other you could find. And neither were they did they go up but as much by degree as many others did. A lot of reasons for that. Separately, I've been asked a lot of questions about the cost of federal regulations is a contributing factor among many others. I'll tell you what I don't believe can be attributed to, at least in our case. Indiana was assessed now retrospectively as the third best state in the country for maintaining its public support of higher education.
That's good.
Tried to send even more money than that, but a reluctant legislature didn't agree with a couple of our ideas. With only one very modest reduction, we were not one of those states that had the big real dollar cuts in public support. So that can't explain it. I think, regrettably, the number one reason was discussed earlier is the now well-documented contribution of free and easy federal dollars, followed by trends in higher ed in which competition has been based too often on non-academic factors, amenities, and so forth.
So it was because the federal loans were easy for students to get, and that was, would you say that was the contributing?
I would say that was,
and not
it's not a sole, it's not the whole explanation, but it is a...
It wasn't state budget cuts.
In some states, I don't doubt that it contributed, but I think the Indiana experience shows that it's not a complete explanation, probably not even the as large an explanation as the so-called Bennett hypothesis, which no longer an hypothesis, I think it's pretty much empirically proven. New York Fed just, I think, is the most recent to find a validity in that.
So, in other words, Purdue was taking advantage of students because they have federal student loans and that it was easy to get, you know?
Well, I think that that's a fair statement. To a lesser extent than most other schools I can point to, our school remains, even at the time that those increases went in place, one of the least expensive in our peer group. And so I tend not to look back at what was, but try to look ahead at an era in which I think value for money finally will become a decisive factor in higher ed.
Well, that's a little discouraging that they just use the student federal money just to raise it and make it harder for more children to come to school. I'd like to ask Mr. Chopra, you know, many students, you read about it, they're being forced into default because of these high loans that they have, has lasting negative consequences for us. What are the main differences in consumer protections between federal student loans and private student loans? What is the contrast between them and the any protections that are there, any predatory practices? Could you give us an overview? This is your area of expertise.
It's like comparing apples and oranges. One of the things that, and you listed some of them earlier, but one of the ones I really want you to think carefully about is the ability to restructure that debt if you happen to graduate in a tough economic cycle. People who entered college in 2005 during the boom of the private student loan market, they graduated in a time that was much different, when an economy was not doing well. And so they had a tough time avoiding default because those private student loans don't include income-driven repayment and term extensions, as you mentioned earlier. It's made even worse by securitization structures where the servicer, the bondholder's trustee, they don't really talk to each other and they can't get to solutions. And this is not just bad for the student, it's also bad for the investors, but it's a symptom of very poor design and thinking up front.
My time has expired. Thank you.
Senator Klobuchar.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to our witnesses. Governor Daniels, unemployment in Minnesota is somewhat similar to Indiana. I was just in your state a few months ago, and there's some commonalities between Minneapolis and Indianapolis, mm-hmm. besides the Appalises. You're at 4.6%, we're at 4%. And I think one of the things that we've found is that we're starting to have job openings in everything from degrees that would be a higher, you know, graduate degrees, four-year degrees, one- and two-year degrees. They tend to be more in science and technology and medical areas. And I'd like to get your perspective as former governor and a college president of what you think we need to do to get students into these areas where we have job openings and make sure they're getting the kinds of degrees we need them to get.
I do think the news is spreading. I think we have a very detectable increase in interest, appreciation among parents and young people of the importance of math and science and the technical education that flows from them. And as I mentioned a minute ago, if we're any indicator, and we are the third most STEM-centric university, public university in the country already, and investing to become even more so. So at least temporarily and encouragingly, I think there is a growth in appreciation for this. We've got a lot of work to do at the K-12 level to have students ready for the rigors of today's scientific education. Mm-hmm. I know from talking to extensively with the president of the University of Minnesota, and you know, we share a concern about that. Every college president will tell you that K-12 improvements are absolutely
right.
Essential.
Because I just keep thinking to make these degrees more relevant and worth the cost those kinds of things, we need to make sure that they're training the kids in the areas where
right.
we have the openings.
No, as we've been discussing, more transparency, and I commended on stage a couple weeks ago Secretary Duncan for the most recent efforts there. We need to go further.
How would you go further?
Well, the first phase there shows, for instance, average income of graduates of school A versus B versus C, and we need to drill down into the specifics because, as you know, in any given university, there's a wide spectrum of career prospects based on what a student decides to study. So, and again, one of the virtues, I think, of a more equity-like financing option is it would send us a market signal. The market would bid differently for the ChemE grad than it might for a graduate of a different discipline.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Chopra, my dad is a graduate of a two-year degree, then went on to get the rest of his degree at University of Minnesota. My sister went to a community college as well, so I have some sense of the importance of that. And I think we know that by 2020, an estimated 35% of job openings will require at least a bachelor's degree, 30% will require some college or an associate's degree. So how does this all fit with the community colleges? And can you talk about that, the cost there, and what can be done to make those degrees more desirable, since some of the openings we have that I mentioned before, whether they're welding or some kind of trades, are 1 and 2 year degrees?
Yeah, I think this goes hand in hand, actually, with our previous discussion about those who are defaulting often are ones who don't complete college and have lower balances. And many of them are going to pretty poorly performing, often for-profit schools. And I think we should think more about how community college investments can be a gateway for people to, in some ways, try college, get that first associate's degree without having so much debt.
Exactly.
And that allows...
And then actually getting a degree where they can work.
That's right. And I think to go on the previous discussion, there is not right now a market incentive for many schools to produce degrees that lead to jobs. We have many, particularly in the for-profit sector, where the market incentive is to revenue maximize with whatever degrees there may be. And in Dr. Kelly's testimony, you can see that the accountability structure is not there in that sector as well as others, that we need to remove some of these low-performing schools that are just having people drowning in debt.
Okay, let's put them aside for a second. I just really want to get at the one and those two-year degrees that are performing and how we make it easier for kids to go to those and incentivize them.
Well, part of that is investing more in those degrees. I think that too many people actually, a lot of people are able to go for free, but a lot of people are not.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Congressman Hanna.
Thank you. And thank you, Chairman. I want to just quickly mention Utica College, which until recently was affiliated with Syracuse University in my district, has lowered their tuition 43%. And at a year when they have had the largest enrollment and applications in their history. And it'll take them 14 years to, at a 3.5% interest rate, to get back to where they are today. And they've done this on their own, so I think that's worth looking at. I'll give you some information on it. The other thing I want to mention is Congressman Kilmer and I, and along with Orrin Hatch, Senator Hatch, have a bill that will allow students or teachers who stay in Title I schools with poverty levels below 40% of the or above 40% of the poverty line to have a direct cash credit to help them fund their college education debt. And in addition to that, along with what Ms. Globuchar was talking about, we also have a bill that I want to ask you about in terms of allowing people to capitalize their debt as if it were an expense like any other business. It's called the STEM Education Opportunity Act, something I wrote out of my office, that would allow someone, regardless of when they pay off their debt, to write off the cost of that, and I'm sure there's a lot more details to be added, but throughout the course of their life, based on when they decided to take it. So they would capitalize it as if a business bought a piece of equipment. For the moment, though, I want to ask, we know that the implications for this huge amount of debt are broad across the economy. And I want to ask each of you if you have a notion of what that means. We know people aren't buying homes this early. We know that people withholding, not getting married, not having children, a whole host of things. So, and we know it's $1 trillion or so. President Daniels, would you like to speak about that?
Well, you said it all, Congressman, or most of it. I guess I would add these are very, very real problems. As I said earlier, we ought to worry most about the damage to the prospects of young lives, but behind that, to the near-term effects on the economy, and they're very real. We're learning more all the time about postponement of purchases, about postponement of business startups and so forth. But we ought not neglect the fact, and you're talking about write-offs, you know, ultimately we're writing off and we're going to write off a ton of federal debt. It's all coming back to visit, will come back to visit itself on these very same young people. So if the average student loan, student indebtedness now is $27,000 to $30,000, they already owe twice that in federal debt that's been run up not by them or not on their behalf, but by their elders, us, for current consumption. And that's an economic it's a huge economic problem, the dominant one, I believe, for the future of this country. And this subject we're gathered on this morning is now a material contributing factor to it.
Have you seen numbers on the what percentage or part of a percentage it might be in terms of our growth to our economy?
Yeah, I mean, there's a mountain of evidence that shows that debt burdens as they grow are a direct penalty on growth. And if you ask me to name the single dominant problem facing the country now, it's that we're staggering it along. It was made mention, historically low growth rates coming out of a recession that deep. And no other problem we face is susceptible to a satisfactory solution while that's the case. And so, you know, the debt anchor that we are already carrying, let alone the one that's right in front of us, is a very real problem for the growth of this country and everything that means in terms of upward mobility, hopes for low-income people, and commitment to, frankly, to the democratic process, which has always produced that hope.
Mr. Kelly?
I would caution against making too many inferences about the effect of debt on the economy from this period in particular. Just because two trends are covariate doesn't mean that one necessarily causes the other. You know, the best study on whether how debt affects home ownership finds very small effects on among student debt on getting a mortgage or obtaining a mortgage. That's a longitudinal study by a researcher at the University of Wisconsin as one of the authors. I would say that part of the problem we have is that the composition of who has student debt has actually changed dramatically as a function of the recession. People went back to college. People left their jobs and they went back to college. Lower income people often. And so those people are going to be less likely to own homes in the first place, and also they're likely to have lower credit scores and so on. So one of the ways to interpret those trends is as part of the access story, that as we invited more people to go back to college, people with debt are going to look like they're struggling more in the economy.
Thank you. My time's expired.
Thank you, Senator Peters.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for our panel for your excellent testimony here today. President Daniels, I just have a question for you, particularly given some of the comments you've made, particularly about the increases that we saw at Purdue prior to your tenure, and Dr. Kelly as well talking about large increases in tuition with colleges and universities across the country. A disturbing trend that I have seen in universities is the increased use of adjunct instructors as opposed to having a full-time faculty, often tenured faculty, who are doing substantial research and other types of activities. And I think some of the statistics I've seen is that roughly 50% of instructors now in universities across the country are part-time instructors. And a majority of these folks are not in a career somewhere and then teaching part-time. This is actually their job, and they have to cobble together either teaching at several universities or having many classes, often earning very, very low wages. And if you look at overall wages for professors, I think the last year was the first increase at 2%, first one above inflation in 5 years. So it doesn't seem as if the money is going into the classroom, particularly when we have this incredible trend to part-time instructors who are living, some of them, not much above the poverty level, even though they have PhDs and substantial education. So where is all the tuition increase? Where is that money going if it's not going into the classroom and going into the professors who are actually teaching our students?
Yeah, Senator, I think you put your finger on something very important. I'm happy to tell you that at Purdue we have very, very few adjunct faculty, a high ratio of tenure and tenure track and clinical or research faculty. But nationally, I believe you're quite correct. This has been the trend, and it simply indicates, and I made quick mention earlier, that too often in higher ed, the terms of competition lately have not been academic excellence. They certainly haven't been affordability. In fact, quite the contrary. The terms of trade, oddly enough, were that in the absence of other evidence, people associated a higher sticker price with more quality. And I don't know the Utica situation directly, but where we see these dramatic reductions in tuition, they weren't collecting it in the first place. It was backdoor discounting through scholarship assistance and so forth. But the dollars that were getting collected too often were invested or spent on amenities and creature comforts and things that people who went to college even 10 or 20 years ago wouldn't recognize. So I think that's all changing. I think the terms of competition are, as they were bound to, shifting, and I hope they will shift very much in the direction of those schools which are maintaining and can prove educational quality and academic excellence for the dollars they're charging.
Dr. Kelly?
I think this concept of shifting the terms of competition is actually the most crucial insight here as to how to write this system. I think this is partly why simply adding more money to the system without changing the incentives that colleges face and how they compete with one another is not going to change a whole lot. It'll be sort of gobbled up by the system as it always is, and then we'll maybe reset the clock for a year and be back where we started. I think the rise of adjunct instructors is really helps to crystallize this incentive structure that colleges actually are not judged on the basis of how much students learn and how well they do once they are out in the labor market. Instead, they're judged on amenities and student faculty ratios and so on. Those things cost money, and hiring adjuncts allows you to save to redistribute some of the money you were spending on teaching to these other things.
Now, I want to push back a little bit in my comments. I don't mean an adjunct is an inferior professor. In fact, adjuncts can be highly skilled, very good instructors. They just simply don't get paid adequately for their services. They're being shortchanged, and so if there's money the university is raising, it's going somewhere else other than paying faculty members who are the people who are actually educating our students.
That's right. Please interpret my point to mean that the university is signaling its priorities by where its money is going. And it's not necessarily going to teaching often because they're paying adjuncts less money. There is some research as to the difference between adjunct faculty and full-time faculty. It tends to find that full-time faculty, have higher performing students. I wouldn't push that too far, and there's been, to my knowledge, no randomized controlled trial of that. But I think your point remains that simply spending more money, the concern is that it won't actually reach the classrooms, that it'll go to other functions and other things without changing the terms of competition.
Great. Thank you. I think I'm out of time.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Hagerty. Congressman Paulson, and then Senator Hagerty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for calling this hearing, just identifying some of the current challenges we have within the higher education system, but it's also refreshing to talk about some new ideas, some new solutions. And it seems that too often the conversation that we have here in Washington focuses on whether or not the student loan interest rates should be 4.5% or they should be 5.5%. And that's an important conversation to have, but we're missing the opportunity really to focus on the real driver of student debt, and that's the rising cost of college. I think we'd all agree that while the difference between an interest rate of 4.5% or 5.5% is noticeable, there's a much larger difference between needing to borrow $15,000 to complete your college education or borrowing $100,000 to complete that education. And with more and more jobs today requiring a college degree, it's likely we're going to continue to see more and more American students choosing to go to college. And so we should be focusing on reining in college costs. And President Daniels, you have become very well known across the country for cutting costs at Purdue, for freezing tuition now for 4 years. Can you talk a little bit more about how you've been successful in getting the Purdue community on board with trimming costs?
Thanks, Congressman. First of all, I'm not particularly impressed with anything we've done so far. I think there's much, much more to do, but it's a start. And I would not overclaim at all. But I like your question because I think it was a central one. I would say this, one of the beauties of our campus or any campus I know is the wide variety of views on almost every subject. It's one of the joys of working at a place like that. But if I could identify one thing that I think is a matter of consensus on our campus at least, it is that we want our doors to remain open as they have been for 150 years. To people of all socioeconomic backgrounds. We're a land-grant school. A lot of people don't know it because of our name and, frankly, I think a great academic record, but we are. And it's very much a core a principle for us. And so, from the beginning, we have asked everyone to contribute. We have a fund, by the way. Many of our faculty, administrators, and staff forego raises voluntarily and contributed to a fund which we use to buy down the cost of next year's tuition. So yes, we're doing those things that I hope will conserve dollars for the real core purpose, which is excellent faculty and the facilities for them to teach in. But I'm happy to tell you, and I believe this would be true on most campuses, that when people are asked to think about it, they very much want to work at and teach at places where no one is denied the opportunity based on economics.
You know, you also talked about one-sided accountability. Can you elaborate a little bit more on what you mean and how you can create a system that actually focuses on more shared accountability among government, universities, students? You know the federal study, the Federal yeah. Reserve study regarding, you know, every dollar of increase in student loan applicability is a 60-cent charge or increase in tuition. You know that same on the Pell Grants, 40-cent increase for every dollar that we put in the student loans.
I think it's pretty straightforward. I was in the healthcare business for a long time, and the parallels are pretty plain. When someone else is paying the bills or large portions of the bills, the buyer is immunized or insulated against the full, at least temporarily, in the case of student loans, against the sense of value that they're acquiring for it. So the schools had it going both ways, a lot of free money coming in one way, nobody measuring value on the other end. And now, fortunately, and thanks to this committee and other leaders here, Secretary Duncan and others, we're beginning to see scrutiny of the results, more public information about the results, and I hope, likewise, some sharing at least of the risk and accountability on the front end. As I said, that we, for one institution, be willing to step up to that.
Dr. Kelly, maybe you can add a little bit on how to have a better accountability system that focuses on that.
So the problem with the current federal rules around financial aid eligibility that are based on the cohort default rate, which is the percentage of your students default after 3 years of entering repayment, it's a binary variable. You're either above the measure and you're out of the system, or you're just below it and you're in with full access to the system, and so that creates little incentive for people below that floor to improve. There's also lots of ways to appeal the department's decision as to whether to kick you out. The result is that very few schools ever lose eligibility, despite horrible outcomes in many cases. So one of the things that we've proposed is a risk-sharing system where colleges would be on the hook financially for loans for some percentage of the loans that go unpaid by their students. Doesn't have to be a large percentage. In the mortgage market, they found that risk retention of 3 to 5% changes behavior. So there's a bipartisan push to do this now, and I applaud that.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Heinrich.
President Daniels, one of the areas where there seems to be some agreement is that shifting the terms of competition is really going to be key to beginning to arrest some of these unsustainable increases, both in terms of tuition and in terms of student loan debt. In addition to apples-to-apples kind of comparisons and scorecards like you've talked about, do you see other tools that can get at that same issue and make sure that we're measuring value?
Yes, sir. In our state and a growing number of states, at least a portion of state aid is now predicated on performance. And it's in early stages. These are imperfect measurements. They do lead to some occasionally anomalous outcomes, but it's the right direction to go. Which is to say that when some percentage, and I hope it'll be a growing percentage, of government assistance, state or for that matter federal, is based on the value of the product being the service being delivered, the graduation rates, the retention and progress rates, and maybe one day the success of graduates elsewhere, you'll have another incentive in pushing in the right direction.
Mr. Chopra, I want to get at another issue that I think in the case of New Mexico may not look exactly like the rest of the country, but which is very important to our students. I'm very proud of the fact that a number of our higher education entities, University of New Mexico, New Mexico State, New Mexico Tech, have actually done a very good job at managing their tuition costs. So we haven't seen the scale of change and increases that we've seen in other places. And I've certainly talked to a lot of students who talk about the incredible importance, oftentimes first-generation students, in Pell Grants and being able to access those relatively modest cost institutions that provide a high value. It led me, in some case, to introduce S1998, the Middle Class Chance Act, which updates Pell Grants to a little over $9,000, allow recipients to use those for 15 semesters instead of the current 12, and use them year-round. Do you have thoughts for some of the traditional financing tools and whether how important they continue to be, especially for low-income students, to get in the door, and in particular with first-generation students?
Discussed earlier, an entry point of community college and using a Pell Grant, often many of those students are able to go almost for free, and I think more of that should occur as long as we're getting good performance out of it. One of the things I'd encourage you also to think further about is how we structure the post 9/11 GI Bill benefit. We have a lot of people that are non-traditional who have served, and in some ways they're not necessarily getting to use those benefits in the most high value way. So, and to echo what others are saying here, you know, accountability to ensure that poor performing high cost schools are not grabbing most of the dollars is critical. And part of that is rigorous enforcement, that if we have standards that people are failing, they need to be kicked out and not be able to get the benefit, whether it's federal aid or the GI Bill or what have you.
I suspect, I certainly in my case, and I suspect many of my colleagues would love to know your thoughts on improving those post 9/11 GI benefits. And I've got a little bit of time here, so why don't I ask you quickly, could you remind us and elaborate a little more than in your limited testimony some of the unique financial pitfalls that our service members and our veterans face when trying to finance higher education, and some of the abuses that we've seen in recent years within that sector of the market?
Yeah, the Congress funds the DOD Military Tuition Assistance Program as well as the post 9/11 GI Bill benefit. There's also specific programs for military spouses as well. And I've been personally troubled at the very aggressive recruiting of people with these benefits. There is a law, a requirement called the 90-10 rule, which requires certain institutions to get 10% of their revenues from non-Title IV sources. And so many of these service members or veterans are seen as nothing more than a dollar sign in a uniform. So I think some of the same principles we're talking about with accountability and risk sharing, we need to think about that more broadly too, to make sure that people aren't just enrolling students to get those GI Bill benefits, but they're actually succeeding.
Thank you all for your testimony. It's very much appreciated.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Lee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks to all of you for being here. It's an honor to have you here, and we always benefit from your insight. You know, this is an exciting time to be involved in a discussion about higher education. I happen to believe we've got the best higher education system in the world here in the United States. It has challenges, yes, and we've got to confront those, but it's an exciting opportunity to be part of this discussion. I look at some of the things that are happening in this area, and I'm encouraged by steps that a lot of people in this field are taking, including, for instance, President Matt Holland, the president of Utah Valley University, recently set up a financial services initiative within this university, a big school and a rapidly growing school within the state of Utah. He set this up for the purpose of providing guidance to students, giving them information to make sure that they know what they're getting into, the implications, the ramifications of their different student financing options. And he did this not in response to a high default rate among his graduates. In fact, Utah Valley University has a very low default rate, or a very high repayment rate, perhaps the highest in the state of Utah. He did this rather because he wants to provide a valuable service to his students. I appreciate what he's doing there and the insight that you've given us today. I'd like to start with President Daniels. You were asked, I believe, a few minutes ago about what kind of transparency is offered to students at your university. I wanted to ask you, what kind of a burden would it be for institutions like yours, administratively and financially, to have to provide information like that, information regarding, you know, average debt load per major, average time to graduate per major, average starting salary per major, and things like that?
Approximately zero. I mean, these things we know or should know, and we do provide it. I wasn't surprised to hear your account of what that that one university has done. It's very like what we've seen and some other schools. I know our sister school, Indiana University, has had good luck, too. I said earlier, a little counseling, a little financial advice goes a very long way, and we have seen a number of families realize they either don't need to borrow or really would be wise not to borrow as much as they originally intended. So I think it's a responsibility, frankly, not particularly a burden, and it's always easier when you don't have to do it. But my sense is that it would any of the things you just mentioned we know now, and would not be an expensive or a burdensome thing to make certain that every student considering financial aid was fully aware of them.
Is there any aspect of existing federal law or existing federal regulatory practice that makes it more difficult to establish programs like that? In other words, is there any change we could make to federal law or federal administrative practice that would encourage universities to do that sort
of thing? Lots of them, as in every other realm. I was part of a hearing a few months ago on this very subject, one which I think maybe a previous question brought up, very important. If we can, we're trying to move to year-round education, we're trying to move to progress at your own rate education, and it'd be really helpful to have some of the financial aid instruments modernized to accommodate that. They were all originally designed for the old traditional start in September, finish in May, agrarian calendar, which increasingly describes the educational experience of a declining minority of our students.
Senator, if I could add,
yes.
The counseling piece is a really good discussion to have, and it's not just at the front end when students are coming in, it's also when they're repaying. That's the case when they're outside of the confines of the school gates. And that's one of the reasons I think we need to take a close look at student loan servicing. These are the companies that are hired to collect debt on behalf of the federal government and other private actors. And they're required to provide students options on how they navigate their debt. And unfortunately, I think we find too many borrowers are being rushed off the phone rather than giving honest and clear information. And this just reminds me too much of what we saw in the foreclosure crisis, where there were options to avoid foreclosure that would have been good for investors and good for the homeowner. And instead, we had businesses cutting corners, and it hurt us all. So we should look at not only in school, but after school as well. Some people have thought about how housing counselors who are now dealing with fewer foreclosures, how they might play a role in assisting student loan borrowers as well.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that insight. I see my time's expired. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator. My list shows that my list shows that it's not so complicated anymore. Senator Cassidy, you're on.
President Daniels, we've heard a lot of testimony that although you say that many of your parents and families are very interested in knowing the cost of education and the value thereof, to me that just shows you got a bunch of engineering students coming to your school, right? The liberal arts person may not be quite as kind of into the numbers. Sound like a stereotype, but apparently the data shows that most students do not pursue that. So I'm intrigued by your ISA, That would be a clear market symbol. But on the other hand, you can imagine if you move beyond philanthropy and loyal alums, and you move into the kind of financier, there's going to be some program that says, oh, this person had a tiger mom. We're going to bet on this person. And this person came from a disadvantaged background, from this zip code, and they're less likely to complete their education, go far. You see where I'm going with that. Any thoughts about that? Because again, this would be a great market signal, but I could see there you want to have some protections, if you will.
Well, we'll only know when we know, Senator, but I can imagine in a fully developed market, these things would work themselves out in very interesting ways. For instance, I suspect that at least initially and maybe always, the most frequent use of an ISA would be to, in essence, recapitalize a student who maybe started with debt, but now has shown some real promise. They've progressed a couple years. There's a lot of data that shows that those first-generation students that you talked about, Purdue has built its reputation on first-generation and low-income students who went out and did great things after achieving a fine education. And some of them might look to the market like the very finest prospects. Convert debt or a large portion of it to an equity-like arrangement. Another thing I would say is we haven't made any decisions yet. We're studying a whole variety of options, but I think early on you would probably see a blended system in which there would be some subsidization by, let's say, loyal alums or philanthropically minded individuals of those students with less certain prospects.
Can I interrupt you for a second?
Please.
Limited time, so I don't mean to be rude. Now, it also seems, I've read about the Grad Plus program, which seems to be somewhat, subject to abuse. Grad schools have raised their tuition, and people who can never hope to get paid back just forego. So this seems like an ideal thing for kind of the grad school component, and I'm just asking your thoughts on that. And
I agree completely. And in the written testimony, I say some pretty direct things about PLUS loans, and both of these gentlemen have written about them, and I think probably have similar thoughts. But yes, I think that's, we ought to get rid of the PLUS loan program, and I think the ISAs could be a partial replacement.
Let me ask Mr. Kelly. Mr. Kelly, you speak about the skin in the game thing, but I've been told by people who know far more than I that if you look at those who have great repayment rates, oftentimes they have very few Pell Grant students. If you will, indicative that they have a kind of better off student body to begin with, and if you will, there may even be deliberately avoiding the implicit federal obligation to take on all socioeconomic class, et cetera, and that you should kind of scale your skin in the game by how many Pell Grants or some other kind of marker for what you're doing for the lower income. Any thoughts about that?
Sure. I think it's crucial that any risk-sharing system acknowledges that tension. The way that we've dealt with it in our writing and in our proposals is to suggest that you couple a risk-sharing system with bonuses for Pell Grant graduates. Now, we don't want to just premise the bonus on enrolling Pell Grant students, because that's going to lead to just more enrollment, rewarding them for enrollment. We want them to be successful. That's one way in which you'd still maintain the incentive for institutions to seek out and enroll Pell Grant students, and in fact, to sort of hedge some of the risk of doing that under the risk-sharing system. I think that gets you 90% of the way there to sort of, getting into risk-adjusted risk sharing where different schools have different standards, I think it's a slippery slope.
Except let me stop you there.
Sure.
Because there are some schools, historically black colleges and universities, who have taken as their mission helping those who are disadvantaged, come from a background, et cetera, you know where I'm going with that. And then there's others who have a rich tradition and frankly take very few Pell Grant students, and many of their parents, all the things you would look for a kid who's going to do well. Should they really be kind of judged on the same scale, if you will? You really want some institutions taking that risk, don't you?
I think you do, and I think that's why you would incentivize them to do so by saying to them, if you're successful with these students, we're going to...
Yeah, but I'm going to your point where you say you wouldn't want to stratify the kind of risk assessment. Maybe I misunderstood what you said.
Yeah, I think that is a slippery slope toward having lower standards, frankly, for institutions that enroll low-income students, and I think that would be a shame.
But... I'm out of time. Thank you.
I'll give you 10 seconds if that's a really, really good question.
Well, no. I do think that if you have a school, say an Ivy League school, which has very few Pell Grant students, and you compare it to an historically black college and university, which is going to have a lot of Pell Grant students, to put them on the same scale is unfair to all. It really makes one look really good and other look pretty bad, but their missions are quite different. So knowing that it could be a slippery slope where you end up with lower standards, at some point do we want to run that risk? Because otherwise we really don't have a good picture of what the demographics of your incoming class. It may not be a great education, you just got great demographics.
I think this is a question about the federal government's interest as a lender, frankly, and whether it wants to lend money to institutions that it knows most people don't graduate from.
Well, I didn't say that. You don't have standards.
So this is part of the tension here. If we want to take access-oriented institutions and make sure that they have the incentive to maintain their access, then we should subsidize that activity
then let me
directly rather than lend for it.
Let me flip it. Someone once told me that the original inclusion of private schools in the whole student loan program was conditioned upon their commitment to taking lower-income people, lower-income students, but that statistically they have not. Mm-hmm. And that if you take Pell Grant as a proxy for doing so, they have just not done it.
Yep.
And so, if you will, there's that flip side, right?
Sure.
You've not expanded access in any appreciable way, and so therefore should the federal taxpayer be subsidizing you? I'm a proud graduate of a land-grant college. I will say that land-grant colleges kind of, I think, get to that sweet spot. But I do think that's the other side of the tension that you're describing.
I agree, and I think this is entirely in keeping with this notion of changing the terms of competition. I think that we have encouraged elite colleges to become more selective, hyper-selective often, and raise their tuition prices to signal that they're a higher quality alternative. All of these things depress low-income enrollment and low-income interest in the school because of sticker shock and so on. So I think the point you're pointing out, the point you're making is well taken.
Mr. Chopra, I didn't mean to ignore you.
I really liked your
Yeah.
Thank you. Well, I think
I'll take it, Congressman.
you raise an important question. Actually, we're going to have a hearing on that subject alone. I appreciate that and appreciate the witnesses. Senator Casey, you've been patient, but the last she'll now maybe even get extra time.
Mr. Chairman, don't open up that door. No, but I thank you for the hearing. We're grateful for this opportunity. I want to thank our witnesses for being here. Mr. Chopra, I'll come to you in a minute, not only to make up time that Senator Cassidy wanted, but also to probe a little more on the state's role here. But I want to start with Governor Daniels. Governor, good to see you again, and appreciate your Pennsylvania roots. Am I right, Monongahela?
Right, you are. Good research.
We wish when people are born in Pennsylvania, they stay, but we lost you, so we'll keep claiming you. But I wanted to ask you about a program that doesn't get a whole lot of attention, but it's the subject of some work here in the Senate this week, the Perkins Loan Program. Mm-hmm. In our state, it amounts to some 40,000 students that benefit from Perkins. Across the country, right around 539,000 students. You know it well, and folks in the room don't know it well. Low interest, fixed rate loans for students with exceptional needs. What we're trying to do this week, and it's interesting that we've got a bipartisan effort, about 25 co-sponsors, to extend the program for a year. Four of the co-sponsors are Republicans, so we do have a good consensus in the Senate on this. The concern, obviously, is that the students that are benefiting here are exceptional need, as I mentioned before. One quarter of all loan recipients are from families with incomes less than $30,000, so not a lot of income. It's, as you know, a revolving loan program, and I'm told, and I want to make sure I'm right about this, Purdue in the 13-14 academic year issued nearly 3,400 Perkins loans. Does that sound right?
I don't know, but it sounds right.
And what's your experience with the program, and what's your sense of it in terms of the Purdue experience?
Obviously, it's played a very important role over time. I'm generally persuaded by the suggestion of those more expert, a couple of them are here, that ultimately reform here ought to be more in a Perkins-like direction, that we ought to have maybe one loan program, ought to be means-tested, you know, among many things we haven't talked about this morning, but the current system subsidizes wealthy families in many respects, and a country that's broke and a program that is consistently overrunning even its own projections and causing more borrowing, you know, ought not be in that business. So I'll defer to those who live in these issues all the time, but my sense is that a simplified program, perhaps offering a federal loan program, coupled with some other vehicles of the kind we've discussed here today, would probably wind up looking more like the Perkins program than the other ones that we have today.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Mr. Chopra, I'll move to you on that question. I want to raise another question as well about the state's role here, but just for a moment on Perkins, if you can speak to that.
I think we always need to be concerned, particularly for loans that are given to low-income students, that it's clearly understood and it's simple, it works well with the other loans they might have. So it feels like a place where broader reform could be needed, and simple extensions might not meet the goals you want, but I'm happy to follow up with your staff further about that.
No, I appreciate that. One of the issues that we discussed today, either by way of the testimony or questions, was the diminution of state investment in public colleges, universities. We're told, if I have the data here, we're told that in a recent study by Center on Budget and Policy Priorities, state spending on higher education nationwide is down to an average of $1,805 per student, which is about a little more than 20%. We're also told that in 2012, that year, per student spending by states reached its lowest level in 25 years. Mr. Chopra, I wanted to ask you about that. Do you think that's a major driver of part of the problem we have? And B, how do we deal with that? What's the best way to deal with that?
Well, one of the things that's always a challenge is data in this area is so poor, but there's no question that state budgets were killed, particularly with the downfall of the housing market. And so we now see the data showing that the percentage paid that consists of tuition from students as the overall budget has increased nationally quite a bit and across most states.
So
The student share is up. So I think we have to start questioning, given that many people are financing that, how do we align the incentives of states not to keep disinvesting, because someone will have to pay for it in one way or the other, either the student through more loans, the families through their own savings, or even the federal government. So I think it speaks to a bad trend, and probably many states are going to regret some of that. And I think there's good work in many states to try and hold their own schools more accountable to make sure they're delivering results.
Well, since I'm the only one between here and lunch, I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Well, Senator Cotton popped back in. We're glad to have you back, Tom.
No lunch for anyone.
You're on.
Thank you all for appearing before us. Thank you for taking the time to help inform us on this very important topic. President Daniels, that sounds nice. Many people wish they could have called you that years ago. You've been in and around Washington, in addition to being the president of Purdue now and a governor as well. When we think about what's driving the student loan crisis, we've heard a lot of testimony today about the easy availability of debt financing that students may not appreciate the terms of repayment, or that may be driving the rate of tuition higher, according to the Bennett hypothesis. Some of that easy availability of debt financing is from relatively low interest rates that have been on student loans, in fact, capped by members of Congress. I mean, in your experience, do members of Congress and senators have the skill sets needed to determine what interest rates should be paid on student loans?
Now, Senator, what kind of a loaded question is that? I admire the skill set of every member of Congress, as you know. My admiration is boundless. I guess what you're asking is, can arbitrarily set interest rates, which therefore amount to subsidies, are they best determined arbitrarily or through some market system? And my answer would be the latter, and wherever they can be. And we've had a lot of good discussion this morning of the ways in which the current system of financing, everything you just mentioned, has contributed to distortions in the market and probably some misleading signals to students, and has certainly contributed very meaningfully to the run-up in costs, which is the root of all this problem. So I don't know that I'm answering your question about the aptitude and capabilities of our members, but I would
diplomatically, you're answering it, yes.
I would say, you know, as it's beyond any of our human capabilities to know with certainty what the right number is for in a setting like that.
Well, that, I mean, Hayek's main proposition is that no matter how smart and capable any person is and how public spirited is, that person will never have all the information
of
millions of people distributed throughout a market. Dr. Kelly, given the rapid increases we've seen in student debt and because of a slow economy, the difficulties so many students are having the ability to repay their loans. Do you foresee a kind of student debt crisis the way we saw in the mortgage finance sector in 2007, 2008?
I don't. I think they're different, very different scenarios. And I think it's important to remember who is actually struggling the most with their debt. And it is not the people with the highest balances. The people with the highest balances tend to have gone to graduate school and have completed a bachelor's degree and then gone on to graduate school. They're doing very well. They have low rates of financial hardship most of the time. So, you know, I think the real crisis here is among people who tried to enroll in a program that was going to expand their economic opportunity but without access to information about which programs are the most valuable and which degrees were in growing fields. I think they often made poor decisions through no fault of their own, frankly. There is downside risk to investing in higher education, and that's why we have created robust protections for student loan borrowers on the back end, like income-based repayment. I think we could change some of the terms of loan forgiveness to make them less perverse and potentially curb tuition inflation. But I think allowing student loan borrowers to tie their payments to their income is a reasonable safeguard against such a crisis.
Senator, if I could add, I don't think it's the same type of crisis, but we have some serious problems. We have 8 million Americans in default, which is going to threaten their ability to get on their feet economically. And I'm worried that we're acting way too slowly. One of the reasons we acted quickly in the last crisis is because it threatened the sustainability and livelihood of large financial institutions. And I don't think students have the same kind of political connections. So we need to make sure that we're thinking about the long game and not just the sanctity of a few.
One alternate means of financing higher education that has been discussed here today is income sharing agreements, which you've piloted at Purdue. I was a sponsor of legislation last year in the House that would have set up a regulatory framework similar to what Congressman Young and Polis have done. Do you think that kind of ISA arrangement should be available to all forms of higher education, four-year degree institutions and students, but also maybe just a student that needs to go back and get a couple of classes to build skills for their local economy?
Instinctively, I'd say yes. Probably ought to walk before we run and see if it works. We talked earlier about the fact that it might well start among the more secure or more promising borrowers, but I can see mechanisms, and we'd like to obviously see mechanisms where it was available more widely and possibly everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Kelly.
Yeah, if I could add, I think one of the virtues of creating space for income share agreements is that they could finance things that currently don't have access to the federal loan program without putting taxpayer dollars at risk, but ensuring at the same time that there are back-end protections by tying the payments to somebody's income.
Okay. Yeah. Well, my time has expired, and I do think I'm standing between everyone and lunch, so thank you all very much for your time here today.
Thank you, Senator. I want to thank our witnesses. I think this is one of the more instructive, constructive hearings that we've had on this committee, and I appreciate the three of you being here to deal with some interesting questions. I want to thank my colleagues who are not here, but I think I can speak on their behalf for their interest in this. Too often we arrive at committee meetings, and the obligation of the chairman and vice chairman to be there is that's all sitting at the dais. Obviously, our witnesses can understand here there's a significant interest in this particular issue, which has major ramifications, particularly as we are living ever more in a global economy. Getting the right flow of talent and skills into our economy is critical to the future of the United States being competitive in an ever more competitive world. Results from the Gallup Purdue Index ought to give all of us a pause in terms of how we can provide better value for the cost that is being endured by students and their parents. And you know, this goes beyond just macro numbers. It goes to individuals who find themselves deeply in debt, living at home, not able to pursue what their parents had thought they had paid for, and that is their opportunity to have the opportunities that we've had. And I was happy that, well, not happy, but I think the question relative to the macro issue here of our ever plunging into more and more national debt is going to have significant consequences, not only in our education system, but just about everything that we do here. So whether it's a medical research or whether it's education or any of a number of other essential issues and things that we ought to be engaged in as a nation is at great risk. And we have to keep our focus on that macro issue as well as the micro issues. And there is an interaction between the two of those. So all in all, I think this is a very constructive day. Thank you again. And with the fall of the gavel, we're adjourned.